Honestly, thank you so much for having me here this morning. And it's such a blessing for Anika and I to be with you guys and to celebrate with you. And congratulations, church, on 10 years. And just want to also say what brilliant people James and Viv are. You guys have been such legends. And, you know, I know that everyone here in this house is so grateful for all that they have done for them. But, you know, I think we got a bit of a picture of it through the video too, that these guys are like spiritual mum and dad to people across the nation and across the world. And certainly for Anika and I, you guys have been such an inspiration and encouragement. You've been there, you know, on the end of the phone in sticky situations that I found myself in. I'm like, what do I do? And you've given wisdom and encouragement and support. We love you guys immensely and bless you for the last 10 years and bless you for the next 10 years to come. Why don't we give them a huge round of applause this morning? It's a tremendous privilege to be able to share, and I'm not going to, I'm going to try to just blast through this really fast because I understand that there is a spit roast after this.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. You know, and we want to have that hot. Amen. Yeah, we want that still to be hot. So if you've got your Bibles this morning, you can turn to Exodus 14. And I want to share with you something that came to me recently while I was reading the Bible and doing a hair journal. Anyone doing hair journals? Yeah, you guys know what those are over here? I think you do. And been amazing. We're talking a lot about them in our church too. And I was reading this particular passage here in Exodus 14, and something stood out to me that I feel is relevant for the church and for you guys in this time and in this season. And the story or the account is about Israel crossing the Red Sea. And we know it's an iconic moment, and it was a full-on moment for them as well because they were being pursued by the Egyptians. It was a desperate situation. The ones who had been holding them captive suddenly had a change of mind and they wanted them back, and they were coming fully armed. But we know, though, that God worked an incredible miracle and brought them not only to safety but destroyed their enemy in the process as well. Pretty cool, though. And so there's this moment where we know Moses lifts his staff, the Red Sea parts, and the Israelites all walk through. And then in Exodus 14, 23, it says this: the Egyptians pursued them, and all of Pharaoh's horses and chariots and horsemen followed them into the sea. During the last watch of the night, the Lord looked down from the pillar of fire and cloud at the Egyptian army, and he threw it into confusion. He jammed the wheels of their chariots so that they had difficulty driving. I want you to notice that. He jammed the wheels of their chariots so that they had difficulty driving. And the Egyptians said, "Let's get away from the Israelites. The Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." Now, I don't know about you, but for me, I'm a bit of a technology nut. Anyone else really like technology here? And I know that your pastor is as well. And I can give you proof of this because the last time that we caught up was in a coffee shop. And we came to the coffee shop. We had coffee together. We shared about, you know, church and encouraged one another. And then we both got our laptops out and we nerded out on productivity software. It was so cool. Sharing Obsidian and all that sort of stuff. Tips on, you know, how to basically get the most out of our PCs. We're nerds, man. It's great. But I tell you what, isn't it amazing the day that we live in today with technology? Isn't it incredible? I mean, I think about this. This is the stuff I used to dream about when I was a little kid. And now, literally today, we're living in the middle of it. You know, we've got these phones that are so powerful. They can make calls and texts and messages and FaceTime, tasks and calendars, email and banking, everything done on your phone. You can play games, you can take notes on it, do it all on your phone. I've got the equivalent of what would have been a multi-million dollar recording studio sitting on my computer and laptop now in the 80s and 90s. You know, there's such incredible power. I thought it was interesting, actually. I don't know who here knows of the singer or recording artist Billie Eilish. Anyone? Yeah, you heard that name? Yeah, so Billie and her brother, Phineas, they got the opportunity to be able to do the title track for the last Bond flick, No Time to Die. And for any artist, you know, to be able to do a Bond flick, I mean, that's a line on the resume. That's a serious thing. You know, she recorded her vocal. Well, he recorded and wrote all the music for that on his notebook in his bedroom, and she recorded the vocal part on a single microphone in the family camper van. And it was mixed and put out in cinemas all across the world. So what you hear is literally the result of that. Incredible, you know, the day that we're living in. And I think technology is making some things easier. And I think as humans, we're really into the idea of having things made easier. And in a way, I think technology and machines and innovations and processes and organization, all of these things are designed and intended to make things better and make stuff a bit easier. But isn't it interesting? Do you notice this? That when I read the scriptures, I find that there is a simplicity in the Word of God that's kind of inescapable. And there is something, regardless of the technological society that we now live in, there is something about God and people, and people and people, that I think there's a simplicity there that we will never find through technology alone. Amen? And I think it's interesting because when I was reading this passage in Exodus the other day, I thought of what I was going to share this morning. And what really stood out to me was that the wheels of the chariots got stuck in the mud as the Egyptians were trying to pursue the Israelites through the Red Sea. And from an outsider's point of view, you would have thought that the Egyptians had the upper hand because they had the more advanced technology. The reason the chariots were invented, they were basically like the technological advance of that day. The reasons they were invented was that you could put troops on those chariots and take them somewhere, and then they'd hop off the chariots and they'd be ready to fight straight away. They were refreshed, as opposed to armies having to march and then rest and then be able to fight. So they were a technological advancement. But the Egyptians, though, found themselves in a moment where their technology was no longer helping them, and where the thing that they thought was an advantage for them actually turned out to be a huge disadvantage. Especially too, because if it wasn't hard enough getting those chariots through the mud at the bottom of the Red Sea, God himself gets involved and starts jamming the wheels. So these guys have got a real problem. You know what? I kind of wonder though, if we find ourselves right here, right now, in New Zealand, in this time and in this age, in a time where God is jamming the wheels of some of the organization and the technology and the processes that we have set up, especially as it relates to his kingdom. Because God has decreed that his glory will be carried by people and not by systems and processes and organizations. Amen? It doesn't mean that organizations are inherently bad. Anytime that you've got a group of people together, you've got to organize. You can bet your bottom dollar there's been a lot of organization and planning going into today because we're bringing a group of people together, and that's okay. But, you know, I'm interested that there is a move of God that is happening all over the nations right now. God is on the move, and it may not be as obvious as something like the Asbury Revival, which is awesome, amen? Come, Holy Spirit. Let's see more of that. Let's see more of people crying out for God and his presence and power flooding. But there's something more subtle that's actually happening across the world as well. It's a move back to discipleship, back to reaching the world, back to the Great Commission. And it's a move from focusing on the big and instead valuing and honoring and seeing the incredible role of the small. Amen? Yeah. It's a true move from the preaching superstar to the Christian wherever you are. Amen? In simplicity. It's not lights, cameras, machines, pyrotechnics, but it's God with people and it's people with people. You know, just because something is latest tech or new and improved doesn't mean that it's most effective. Amen? I'm sounding like a bit of an old man. But you know what? Just also too, because we've always done it a certain way, doesn't mean that that way is going to work going forward. And also, too, means that the way that we have been doing it wasn't even necessarily the way it was originally designed. You see, Jesus said, you make disciples and I'll build the church. Whereas what we've said, and I know I've said this, Jesus, I'll build the church, and I'm hoping that somewhere along the line you might make some disciples. But there is this beautiful simplicity that I think that Jesus is bringing back into our Christian life. It's an authenticity. It's something simple and something that just works. And it brings life. You know, about 15 years ago or so, we had some friends who came over to spend an evening with us. And that, when I met them at the door, the guy walked in. He had a box under his arm. And I looked and said, what's in the box? And he said, it's a board game. How many here love board games? Quite a few. How many despise board games? A few more, yeah. I'm kind of in the despise board games. I was like, oh no, a board game. But you know what? The fact is though, friends come over. It's like, that's fine. We'll play a board game. This is all good. What's the board game called? You said it's called The Settlers of Catan. Anyone played that game or know what that one is? Okay. Anyway, so they brought this game over and they set the whole game up, and I was looking at this thing thinking, man, this looks pretty complicated. You know, there's all these tiles there and there's this, you know, there's cards and there's a robber and there's dice and there's all this stuff going on. And then the guy said something that really made me happy. He said, I'll just give you a quick explanation of the rules and then we'll just have a go at playing the game because it's probably better just to kind of figure it out as you go along. I love that. I mean, if I'm going to have to play a game, what I can't stand is there's somebody there who feels like they've got to read every single one of the rules before we can start to play. Amen? Anyone with me on that?
Yeah.
This is like, let's play this game. So anyway, we started playing this game, and it took us two or three times of playing the game to kind of get the feel of it. But then we were like, man, we really enjoy this. It's a great game. So we played it two or three more times that night, probably five or six times in that one night. And then as they were leaving, we said, man, that was so much fun. What are you doing on Thursday night? They said, oh, no, nothing. We said, do you want to come over? So later that week, they came, they bought the game back. We played the game again. We enjoyed it. We loved it. We got together with them a whole bunch over that next while and played that game. It was awesome. And then at some point, Anika and I looked at each other and said, you know, we're really enjoying playing this game. Maybe we should buy ourselves a copy of the game. So we went out and bought ourselves a copy. And so we started playing the game at home and playing with our kids and stuff. And then a little while later, some friends invited me over. You know, well, invited us over for an evening. And so I turned up, and guess what? I had a box under my arm. What's in the box? It's a board game. And so we taught this to our friends, and they really enjoyed it as well. And they thought, mate, this is great. So they went out and they bought their own copy, and then they, in turn, took it to all of their friends. And it just went on and on and on. And friends, that's what it looks like when something goes viral.
Yeah.
Now, the interesting thing, there's two things that I thought was interesting about this. Number one, is that when we taught the game to the second couple, the first couple weren't there. Not only that, but we didn't have to say, oh, if you want to play the game, we're going to have to take you back to the first couple to get them to show you how to play the game, because we could just show them how to play it. And the second thing, which I think is even more important, is that I didn't have to pay a subscription or register or go to a training course or be authorized or ordained or trained or whatever in order to be an official representative to be able to teach somebody else how to play the game.
Excellent.
All I needed to do was to love the game and be able to pass it on. And you know what? When things go viral, that's what it looks like. And I believe that 2,000 years ago when the church started, it was viral.
Yeah.
When the Holy Spirit fell on that day on Pentecost, it just exploded and went everywhere. Why? Because anyone could do it. Anyone could be a part of this thing. Anyone, wherever they were, whoever they were, could take this and pass it on to someone else. But, you know, somewhere along the lines, it got institutionalized. Somewhere along the lines, we stopped playing the game and thinking that anyone could pass it on, and only special people could now pass it on. You had to be trained in order to pass it on. You had to go to courses and have particular credentials and stuff in order to be able to pass it on. And, you know, so the whole thing is kind of, you know, and then we stopped playing the game and we just started going, listening to other people talking about playing the game or going to conferences to learn better strategies for playing the game that we weren't actually playing. Whoa, hello. But you know what? I think it's time for the church to go viral again. And I think it's time that we need to lose control, guys. Because what happens when something goes viral is that you lose control. It just takes off. And that's what I believe we need to see again. You see, so the challenge that I'm giving all of my people in our church, and I know that James is giving a similar one here, is this. Simply, whoever you are, and whoever you are in this room today, find two people that are open and interested to Jesus and take them on the journey of discipleship. Teach them the basics of the game for 6 months, then finish the group and everyone in the group finds two more people and you start again. That's it. Simple. You don't have to know everything. You don't have to be a Bible scholar. And in some ways, it's better if you're not. Actually, because when someone's asked you a question, you say, I don't know the answer. Let's go and find out together. So good. It's, you know, discipleship is not me telling someone everything that I know, which isn't going to last very long, to be honest. It's not me telling everyone. It's me and that person coming to the Word of God and saying, Jesus, what are you saying to us? And putting that into practice. That's what discipleship looks like. It's not this way, it's this way. Amen? It's not about what you know, it's about what you're doing with what you know. Yeah. The last thing I think that most Christians in the West need is another conference or Bible school or podcast or YouTube sermon. Whoa, hello. You see, because here we think that spiritual growth is about learning more. Oh, I went to that conference and I heard something I'd never heard before. That guy preached and he showed me something in Scripture. I like to think about that. I've grown. No, you haven't grown. Spiritual growth is not about learning more. It is about what you've done with what you've learnt. Who cares what you know if it's not changing your life? And Jesus himself said this. He said the difference between the person who builds on the sand and the one on the rock is, he said, the one who builds on the sand and on the rock, they both hear him preach. They both hear his words. But the difference, though, is that the one who builds on the rock is the person who puts his words into practice, who does something with what they know. And I love this because it puts everyone on the same playing field. It doesn't matter today if you're a Bible college professor and you've been walking with God for 40 years, or if you got saved last Thursday. It actually doesn't matter, because you can sit down and read the Bible, and when you read the words of God and he calls to you, you're going to have to do something with that. And both of you are on exactly the same place. There is a revival of obedience that's coming to the Western world. Amen. And it's absolutely necessary, because I tell you what, in terms of effectiveness, for the very first time since the birth of the church, Christianity globally is actually declining. And it's not because of persecution, and it's not because of the radical left, and it's not because of the media or anything else that we often think. It's because of the birth rate of our world. There are so many people being born right now that our 20th century methods are simply not keeping up with what we have to reach. So the big crusades, the pure attractional model, the lights, the glitter, the music, as much as we love it all, it's awesome. But we need something better to be able to reach our world. We need something that is viral. And I just want to just throw some numbers at you just quickly. If I invest into two people for 6 months and then into another two people after that, and if I go on and do that for 5 years or for 10 years, then after 5 years, I would have personally been involved in seeing 20 people walking deeper with God. That's if no one I disciple does anything with it. I will be involved in seeing 20 people walk deeper with God, and after 10 years, 40 people walking deeper with God. And people might look and go, well, that doesn't sound like much. But I'll tell you something. One day I'm going to have to stand before God. And when I stand before God, I want to be able to say to Jesus, thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Thank you for the gifts and the talents and the opportunities and the Holy Spirit, everything that you put in my life. And I don't want to just be, so thank you for all of that, and here I am. I want to be able to turn around and say, thank you, Jesus, that you saved me. And because you saved me and worked through me, I had a part to play in all of these ones who are here with me as well. I want my life to have an impact. How about you? You know, and if I invest into two people for just 6 months, and after that, just one of those people goes and starts another group, and it happens again and again and again, then after 5 years, there's now 1,000 people in that crowd. And after 10 years, there's 1,000,000 people in the crowd. That's the power of viral. That's only one of those people doing it. None of us knows how far our lives can influence. At the start of the 20th century, there was a Kentucky farmer called Tobias Ham. You've probably never heard of him. He felt called to preach. He dutifully spent his life preaching and ministering. He saw a lot of people come to God. But one night in one of his meetings, there was a young kid who came, who sat in, who was more interested in baseball than God. But God touched his life that night, powerfully used him, and his name was Billy Graham. We have no idea that one person that we are reaching out to, what God is going to do through them and through their life. We have no idea how far these things can go. And just for completeness sake, because this never happens, but just for completeness sake, if I start a group with two people and then that group multiplies again and again and every person in that group reaches out again and again, after 5 years, there's 60,000 people in that crowd. And after 10 years, get this, 2.3 billion. That is the power of viral. And that, my friends, is what I believe that God wants to release in the church. And look at that. I didn't even set that, but you know, that's right on cue for the end. It's telling me it's lunchtime. That's the power of vile. I just wonder if I can grab the worship team up. Can you guys come up? Can we sing just to be worthy of it all, just as we finish up this morning? You see, the reason I bring this up today is that this stuff is not a method to grow a church, because you might reach out to someone at your work, and that person might reach out to someone in their sphere of influence, and you may never know where this stuff ends up going. It's not necessarily going to grow your church, but it will grow the kingdom of God. And that's what I think really matters. And you know, just as I finish up this morning, in the beginning, God gave Adam and Eve a command. And he said, spread out and multiply right across the face of the earth. Fill the whole earth. But instead, though, a few generations after Noah, literally humanity did the exact opposite. They all gathered around a tower and they tried to build it up. Why? Because they said that we wanted to make a name for ourselves. And as you stand here, or as you sit here this morning, as a church, at the 10-year mark, I believe that there's a challenge that God is giving every single person here in this place. Will you live to make his name great, or are you going to live to make your own name great? Are you here to build a name for yourself, or are you here to lift his name up and to see his name reach? Are you content just to get yourself over the line and there on that last day? Or do you burn to bring a whole host of people with you as well? To be that servant who says, thank you, God, for what I was given. And look, here's 10 more. Look, here's 100 more. Look, here's 1,000 more, God. You know, so many have disqualified themselves. And there's even people sitting here in this room, and you have disqualified yourself from the call and the mission of God. Because for so many years, we have said, you know, if you can preach, if you can lead, if you can play an instrument or sing or whatever, then yes, we've got a role for you at church. Yes, you can be part of the kingdom of God. But what I love about this is that you don't have to have anything special. In fact, you don't even have to feel like a special person. My wife brought a brilliant message just recently, and she said, you know what, it's not special people that are changing the world, it's willing people. It's available people. I wonder if there's some willing and some available people here this morning. Why don't we stand to our feet as we finish up this morning? Heavenly Father, I thank you today, Lord, for your call. I thank you for this church. Lord, I thank you for 10 incredible years, for every person. Lord, the ones who are here right now, the ones who are scattered across the nations, the ones who are serving you in other places, God, because of the touch of heaven that came to their life. Lord, in this house and through this house, Father, we stand in awe of all that you have done, Lord. And we just want to say, Lord, as we sang this morning, thank you, God. Lord, you have been so good. You have been so good to us, Lord. And we thank you for your goodness to us, God. But Lord, as we stand here this morning, we also want to say with the prophet, Lord, here am I, send me. Father, I thank you, God, that as your word said, that the glory of the latter house will be greater than the glory of the former house. Lord, I thank you, God, that the reality is that you were the God who was, that you are the God who is, but you remain always the God who is still yet to come. And because of that, the best is always still yet to come. God, you are waiting for this church in the future. And Father, I pray this morning, Lord God, for each and every person here, Lord, not that this would just be one place, Lord, that is built up like a tower to make its own name great, but Father, that it would spread out all over the world in every direction, taking the goodness and the grace and the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to the far ends of this earth. And Lord, that you would use each and every one of us, Lord, whether we are heading overseas, whether tomorrow we're just going to be back at work and next to that work colleague who is open and interested. Father, would you bring into our lives those who are looking for you, those who are searching for God, those who are hungry, those who are ready. Father, put us in fertile soil. Put us around open hearts today, God, that your kingdom may advance, Lord. And as you prayed, Lord, that your kingdom would come and your will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. Father, I bless this church today in Jesus' name. And just right now, if that's you, if on your heart this morning, you're just like, God, that's me. I want to be where you are, Lord. I want to go where you send me. Lord, open my eyes and open my heart. Would you just raise your hands this morning, right now? Heavenly Father, I just pray, Lord, and I bless every hand that is raised, every person here this morning. Father, I ask, God, that even as they just indicate their willingness to you, Father, that you would use them. Father, I command this morning divine opportunities, incredible divine appointments. Father, I thank you, Lord God, for situations. There's people here in this building, and you've been praying for your work situation, and nothing's shifted, but I'm telling you that you're going to go back even this week, and something is going to shift in the environment, in the atmosphere there. Suddenly people are going to be open. There's people here this morning, you've got family members on your heart, and you've been praying for them for so long, and nothing's happening. I'm decreeing this morning in Jesus' name for those doors to open and something to shift today, right now. Father, I thank you, Lord God, all around our lives, Lord, for the gospel and the power of the kingdom of God to just explode, and for, Lord, greater things yet to come. We pray in Jesus' name.